of scientific projects, a place where tomorrow's ideas are here today. The Natural Energy Lab at Keaholi Point is a place where new and exciting things are constantly happening. And tonight, we'll bring you the first in our series of reports, beginning with Cyanotech Corporation, where new concepts are being fully realized.
Cyanotech comes from the word cyanobacteria, which are blue-green algae. And really, all of our technology is based on microalgae. Well, essentially, it's a microscopic plant, and the ponds contain a very high population, many millions of cells per milliliter, and they continually grow and multiply, and we harvest the spirulina as they grow, wash the spirulina, and then dry it, and sell as a high-protein powder. Right now, we're producing two products, spirulina and beta-carotene, and the green ponds that you see behind us are spirulina. We produce about 3,000 kilograms, or almost 6,000 pounds of spirulina a month. The orange ponds are beta-carotene, or actually the algae there is called NELHA. Very interesting, that algae contains up to 10% beta-carotene. The next highest natural source of beta-carotene is carrots, which only contains 0.1%. So our algae has over 1,000 times higher concentration of beta-carotene as compared to carrots.
The complex sits on 15 acres of state land. There are 14 ponds on site, measuring 600 feet in length, 50 feet wide, but only 12 inches deep.
And the reason for that is a properly run microalgae culture, you can adjust everything except the light. And so we run these ponds in a light-limited mode to get the highest productivity out of the ponds, and as a result, a large surface area and very shallow depth. A constant agitation is, once again, related to light. We want to be able to mix the cells up, make sure that cells don't stay in the bottom where there's very little light, get to the top where they can get some light. It also aids in making sure that the nutrients get to each cell. Spirulina is a very good protein source. It contains 60% protein at least, and it's a very balanced protein. Beta-carotene is used as a food coloring. Typically, it's also finding its way more and more into nutritional products due to the fact there have been a number of studies showing that increased levels of beta-carotene in the diet reduce the risk of cancer. These are studies sponsored by the National Cancer Institute. And as a result, more carotene is going into nutritional products, and the market is picking up substantially for beta-carotene.
Jerry and everyone at Cyanotech are very excited about what the future has to offer. They're constantly experimenting with new ideas and will continue to be a major contributor to this combined project known as the Natural Energy Lab of Hawaii. Located just across the street from Cyanotech is another project that's farming a different kind of product. Royal Hawaiian Sea Farms specializes in something we here in Hawaii have seen many, many times.
Well, we're growing edible seaweeds, sea vegetables, and the main ones that we're growing is the fresh nori and ogo. And we're working on techniques to develop different strains and also develop two or three more edible seaweeds. This is the nursery tank for the seaweed nori, and it starts out as a microscopic spore, and it settles onto the net. It needs something to settle on, or else it will just die. It settles on the net in about 4 weeks. It reaches a size, 4 to 5 weeks, it reaches a size where we can trim off a piece of it and put it down into the grow-out tanks. The rocking motion is to simulate water movement across the plant, which allows the nutrients to be absorbed by the plant. The water acts as a fertilizer. What it is what we're doing here is basically marine hydroponics. The seawater is rich in nutrients, so we do not have to add fertilizer, and that's one of the benefits of using this OTEC water. And they grow very fast. The time from putting it into the tank to harvesting it is very short. Down here, it's only a 7-day grow-out period. So we harvest every week. The ogo we harvest every week. The nori, from the spore to harvesting, takes about 6 weeks. So it's relatively quick, and it allows for a good cash flow. In theory, it allows for a good cash flow.
The project first got on the drawing board back in 1982. From there, it progressed to this one-acre facility, and Steve hopes the growing trend will continue.
The future is very bright. We're have plans to expand to another acre, and we haven't even been here for a year to grow other seaweeds and ogo and nori. Yeah, the future looks very good.
Royal Hawaiian Sea Farms and Cyanotech Corporation are just two of the many projects that are happening down here. We invite you to join us in the coming weeks when we'll bring you more of our series of reports from the Natural Energy Lab of Hawaii. Next up tonight, we continue our series of reports from the Natural Energy Lab of Hawaii, this time around, a story that we hope will satisfy the sweet tooth in all of us. On our visit, we found that things are really growing around here. In fact, you might even say that everything's coming up strawberries.
The idea started really long ago when I became quite interested in the OTEC process. That's basically what this Keaholi Point is all about, is finding other uses for cold water. And the one that came to my mind was using refrigerated soil. So I don't use the seawater in the soil. I'm not watering plants with seawater, but I'm using it to cool down the soil to grow things that like cooler climates. The most successful that we've grown so far have been strawberries, where the cold soil increases the sugar content and increases the yield, sometimes as much as five times over growing it in uncooled soil. We've grown lettuce, and called radicchio, which is a red lettuce. It's the alstroemeria flowers, which I guess you'll be taking some pictures of, thrive in this atmosphere. They're alpine plants that like cold soil, but like sun. And they found on the mainland by growing these plants experimentally in totally in controlled environments, that cold soil and warm sun is what they like the best.
Marty keeps his refrigerated soil at a constant 40 degrees. He does this by weaving copper tubing throughout the dirt in which the cold seawater is pumped. And by mixing the cold with the warm, he's able to get the precise working temperature that he wants. Keep in mind that he's not watering the soil, but instead using the cold water to cool the pipes, which in turn cools the soil. All of this done through the untapped potential of our Pacific Ocean.
I'm a firm believer that the ocean has a lot to offer us that we are not using. And this is a particular use where we're not causing any environmental harm. We're really enhancing production, enhancing food production by using the deep nutrient water that occurs naturally in places like the coast of Chile, where cold water is pushed up by natural means. Here we're using electric pumps to do the same thing on a much smaller scale.
Just next door is a facility where creepy, crawling creatures are all over the place. This type of farming is the newest addition to the Natural Energy Lab, a project that started about 10 years ago over on the mainland, and today, here in Hawaii, is featuring what you might call homegrown lobsters.
All the lobsters that you've seen have been hatched and raised by us. None of them have ever been in the ocean. We have over 2,000 lobsters here. So what we've learned is basically been by trial and error and experience. Because there aren't other people to go learn from, specifically about how to raise lobsters.
The animals are housed in their own separate plastic cages, which provides protection during their molting stages, a time in which they lose their shell and grow new ones. Most of these lobsters weigh around 3 pounds, and they eat almost anything that's put in front of them.
Lobsters are carnivorous, and they're scavengers in the wild. So they'll pretty opportunistic, they'll eat what they come upon. They really aren't plant eaters. So we've been experiencing trying to feed them ono and ahi and marlin, which they've been taking fairly nicely.
The female will lay up to 4,000 eggs, which Phil hopes to someday develop into a system in which eggs are hatching on a regular basis.
That 1-inch lobster you saw is 15 days old. And from there to 1 pound is going to take us 2.5 years. The broodstock room we were in is a temperature controlled room in which we hope to be able to convince the lobsters that it's actually February instead of August. that way we can control the breeding cycle so that we'll be able to get eggs every month of the year. The product is that we've had taste tested is fine. It compares very favorably with wild caught lobsters. And it looks like it's going to be economical. It looks like there's enough margin there to grow them profitably.
Who would have thought that lobster farming and strawberries would become an integral part of this complex? We invite you to join us in the coming weeks when we'll bring you more interesting surprises from the Natural Energy Lab of Hawaii. In our series of reports from the Natural Energy Lab of Hawaii, we found some very interesting and innovative projects going on down there, but none so complex and involved as the technologies of Ocean Farms of Hawaii, a company that's been in Kona since 1984, trying to utilize the waters of the Pacific to its fullest potential.
This facility here is unique. There's no place in the world where there is a continuous supply of fresh, cold, deep seawater. And the animals that we grow, abalone, salmon, the species of oysters we grow, kelp, and sea urchins, they're all cold water animals. So this cold water is not only constantly cold at the right temperatures for us, but it's also very pure. There are no diseases that either affect these animals or affect humans.
Pure, rich, and clean water that's used for their aquaculture projects, all of which starts with the growing of kelp, a brown algae used for food that begins its cycle of life as a tiny spore attached to these tiny rings.
So they're on the rings and they're microscopic. After a month, month and a half or so, they become visible to the naked eye. And then when they get to be, about the size of your thumbnail or so, we can start thinning them. We can then take those rings and move them. All right? And we spread them out on another rod in these other tanks. And we raise them for another month or so. At that point, we can take them and outplant them, either into the kelp tanks or up into the kelp pond.
The divers will work out of these two main tanks or their brand new 20 million gallon, 4-acre pond. The kelp is brought here to fully mature.
What we are doing here is trying to, or we are, recreating the environment that kelp grows in naturally. Okay, and that's the environment along the coast of California. That includes keeping the temperature typical of that area and the nutrients, and one real critical feature is water motion. And what the bubbles do is you have air lines across the bottom, the bubbles come up, and as the bubbles come up, it creates movement of the water up over the kelp, which provides two things. One is it assists in the transfer of nutrients from the water into the kelp, and it also prevents other plants from growing on the kelp as long as the kelp is moving.
So from here, it's now feeding time. The kelp is grown for the sole purpose of feeding these little creatures. The abalone live here in the grow-out area in their little condominium, so to speak, till they're ready for market.
This is a 3-inch abalone, which is approximately our marketing size animal. You would receive two of these. As a customer in a restaurant, you could expect to receive two abalone, approximately 3 inches in size, and that would consist of the main course. It's like I said, basically, it's a very delicate flavor and texture, and that's its attraction. That's the appeal to many people.
The male abalone, as you can see, is quite large. The female can produce up to 20 million eggs. Another use for the same seawater lies in the caring for these spiny animals.
These are giant red sea urchins. We brought these guys over from California, and they live at about, optimally at about 16 degrees, anywhere from 14 to 16 degrees Celsius. Okay. We maintain them in these tanks at about a flow rate of about 2 liters a minute. And that's just enough to keep the chemistry of the water optimal and to allow the temperature to optimize.
The animals are easily handled, and a quick flip reveals their foot and mouth area. Their long needles are mainly used for movement and protection. But if it's fish you're looking for, well, they've got that covered too. Salmon is beginning to make a big splash at Ocean Farms of Hawaii.
It's a cold water animal that lives in the same temperature of water as kelp. In addition, it commands a pretty good market price. So really those two points were the attractive ones for us. We haven't really raised any batches up to full maturity yet. The largest salmon currently on the farm are probably about 3 pounds. But we anticipate probably 2 years to get them to 4 to 6 pounds.
Since all projects here at the site involves ocean water, maintaining consistent quality control is very important.
The water that's coming in is, you know, basically nice, pure, clean water. It's once it's in the tank, you have to watch out that you're not getting a buildup of waste, that you're not getting, too much of one thing or another. We do a weekly check of basically all the tanks. And then there's other tanks that we look at. So it sort of depends on the area that we're looking at.
And another animal that loves to cool off in these clear waters is the oyster. Here you'll find them basking in the sunlight by the thousands.
We get them 400,000, 500,000 at a time, up to a million. And they're almost like a grain of sand. They're like 1 millimeter, 2 millimeter in size when we first get them. Put them in small screens, you know, so they won't go through. And then we have built upwelling boxes and grow them until they're like an eighth of an inch, a quarter inch, and then we move them into more of a plastic mesh net so that then we can move them into our big tanks. From 1 millimeter size up, 2 years, we can have them to be sellable, to be on the market shelves.
In terms of local expenditures, we have invested millions of dollars in this facility, much of which has been expended here in the local community for construction services and for employees and whatever. Right now we employ about 35 people. 2 years from now we should be up to about 200 people. Well, we will continue to expand here. We will expand into the host park. We anticipate having a total of about 100 acres in production, which will be, that kelp pond we have, we'll have about 20 of them all together. And we'll be producing an awful lot of fish. It could well be, I've said this jokingly to Governor Waihei, but it could well be that Hawaii will become the principal salmon-growing state in the United States.
Ocean Farms of Hawaii is making a huge contribution to Kona as well as the aquaculture industry by developing such a facility, and so are the other projects found here. We invite you to tune in the coming weeks for more of our series of reports from the Natural Energy Lab of Hawaii. Next up tonight, we again visit with our friends down at the Natural Energy Lab of Hawaii for a story that promises to get you all charged up. Tonight, we'll take a look at an experiment known as OTEC, Ocean Thermal Energy Conversion, a process in which our seawater will someday be used to generate electricity right here in Kona.
This is an experiment that's called Heat and Mass Transfer Scoping Test Apparatus. It's DOE's OTEC experiment. It's an open cycle OTEC plant where steam is created directly from the seawater. This particular experiment is just being used to test some of the key components to that system. It will be used to help design another experiment where we will have a turbine and actually be producing electricity.
At this point, the plant is not generating power, but all the components here are being tested for future use. The way electricity is generated is by boiling the ocean water. And the way that's done is by, in a sense, raising the elevation of the water in a pressurized chamber. For example, at sea level, water boils at 212 degrees. On top of Mauna Kea, water boils at 205 degrees, and way up at around 40,000 feet, water boils at room temperature. This chamber duplicates that high altitude, and the result is water that boils at room temperature. In this diagram at the bottom left-hand corner, warm seawater is pumped into the facility. It's then pressurized in the evaporator. The steam produced by the boiling water is used to turn the turbines, which in turn generate power. In the condenser, the steam mixes with cold seawater, which turns the steam back to ocean water, and as a byproduct, the surface condensated water can now be used as fresh water, which is very suitable for drinking. All of this done with extreme regard for our environment.
There are concerns. There's nothing that appears to be, they can't be handled in a very safe environmental manner. One thing is that when the water is brought up and run to the plant, its temperature has changed. And so when we discharge that water, we have to make sure that we put that water back in the ocean in a place that will not affect the sea life. And one way to do that is to have a pipe that goes out to the place where water is the same temperature as our used water, and put the water back in at that point. Then it shouldn't have any significant effects on sea life.
The concept was first developed back in 1881, and now, looking towards the future, Hal and the rest of the folks here at OTEC hope to be generating 150 kilowatts of environmentally clean power by the year 1992, something that gives him a great deal of personal satisfaction.
It feels real good to be working on a project that has potential to deal with one of the major problems facing our country and the world today, and that is that there are only so many fossil fuels out there, and even there's only so much oil, and there seems to be a lot more coal, but burning coal has a lot of problems. It puts carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, puts radioactive gases in the atmosphere, it puts sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere, causes acid rain. So if we can come up with alternatives to that, we're going to be way ahead. And by working on this particular technology, I'm hoping that to make a better situation for my kids to grow up and for their kids. So that gives me a good feeling in my heart.
Visits down at Keaholi Point, we found that the Natural Energy Lab of Hawaii is truly a place where tomorrow's ideas are here today, a place where yesterday's dreams are now being fully realized. It all started back several years ago when then-Governor John Burns and Hawaii County Mayor Shunichi Kimura both saw the need for the production of alternate energy here in Hawaii. In 1974, the Natural Energy Lab of Hawaii was officially established. 322 acres of state land was set aside for the research and development of energy-related technologies. By bringing up both warm and cold seawater and finding ways to properly utilize this resource, scientists here have discovered a clean, pure, nutrient-rich energy source right in their own backyard. And while all of this is still new to Kona, the idea itself has been around for many years.
It was an idea that was with many years. For many scientists, such as John Isaacs of Scripps, that pointed out that this deep ocean water was ideal, but he also pointed out that in order for nature to have used it, it would have had to have plants that had roots that were 2,000 feet long. And that there was no way for nature to develop a plant with roots that length. And so one way of looking at our pipelines are as artificial roots down to this rich soil that's down in the deep ocean water. That's one way of looking at it. A second reason that people have not looked at it is because this involves very large quantities of fluid and large installations. And people thought that this would be very expensive because large installations are very expensive on land. And finally, there were people who did not know much about ocean technology who perceived there were many problems. And this laboratory here has been working since 1974 to solve these problems and to demonstrate that they are easily overcome, and we have done so. The advantage of ocean thermal energy is that it is a source of energy which is as large as the world's total need of energy in the oceans. That it is a source of energy that does not generate carbon dioxide, which causes the very bad greenhouse effect. It is a source of energy which does not generate any extra heat. It is a replacement for air conditioning, In normal air conditioning, you use a tremendous amount of power. While you cool the building, you generate a lot of heat for the environment outside. When you use air conditioning with deep ocean water, you only cool the building, and you do not use much electricity. So the source of cold, as a cheap source of cold, and as a source of cold which doesn't require the production of hot. In almost all of the refrigeration techniques that we use on the land, we produce as much hot as we produce cold. And so we have an illusion that we've made the environment colder. We've only made the room colder, or we've made the freezer colder. We've made the rest of the world warmer. When you do cooling with deep ocean water, you do make the room cooler and the rest of the world cooler as well. I think that we're already seeing greenhouse effects. I think that there will be more greenhouse effects that we have yet to see. But the greenhouse effect is reversible. You can slow it down. It's really just a function of the total amount of carbon dioxide that you put into the air each year. So OTEC is one of the few systems that gives us the chance to make mobile fuel and fixed power installations that produce no carbon dioxide in the process. And every time you replace a power source with this, you're cutting down on the carbon dioxide going into the atmosphere. We are just scratching the surface here. We have done all sorts of exciting things in terms of the growth of salmon and of trout and of abalone and of oysters and of algae of various kinds, almost too many to enumerate, and yet we have just scratched the surface of the things that we can grow and the biotechnology that we can do in that regard. We have just barely begun to start to develop various forms of energy production. Open cycle process, which produces fresh water as well as energy, and the closed cycle process. But there are many, many possible cycles and processes that can be used. We have so far done only installations that exist on land, except for our first demonstration project, Mini OTEC, which was on a barge. But we know that the final installations will all be done on giant floating facilities, which are located offshore. So we're at the very embryonic stage of what is going to be a global enterprise, in my opinion, to rival the enterprise for oil in terms of production of energy, and to be far superior in terms of its political stability, in terms of its environmental soundness, and in terms of its ability to be utilized by the peoples of the world.
We hope you enjoyed watching our ongoing series of reports from this extraordinary complex at Keohane Point, a place that can teach all of us some important lessons about our environment and how to make our world a better place to live in for our children's children. We hope to return in the near future to find out what other new and interesting surprises they have since discovered. So remember, the next time someone asks you where in Hawaii can they find a place that grows spirulina and beta carotene, or even edible seaweeds such as nori and ogo, or how about strawberries, lettuce, and even flowers, delicious homegrown lobsters, abalone, salmon, oysters, and yes, even sea urchins. And also a place where generating electricity will soon become a reality. Well, tell them it's all happening right here at the Natural Energy Lab of Hawaii.
Go again, right?
And we'll set him back.